Hi, this is Joe McConnell coming to you from Light Elegance in Redmond, Oregon with Morris.
Hey guys.
Liz is our guest speaker and my compadre for these videos.
It's super fun filming with Jim for his Chemist Corner, and I am a very big nerd, and so I always love to nerd out when we do these collaborations. It's really fun.
It's great to have her. We bounce off each other.
Absolutely. Yeah. Jim is just a wealth of information. And as a nail tech who likes to be really knowledgeable about what I'm doing, every time I ask you a question, I get more and more education about, you know, the products I use, the lamps that I have, and also some of the issues that I run into as a gel nail tech. And this series that we're doing right now is about heat, right?
Heat.
Yeah.
Heat's an important thing.
Yeah, so we have gone through, you know, what exothermic reactions are. We've talked about gel formula and how that plays a role in exothermic reactions. So if you guys didn't catch those first videos, please go back and start the series from the beginning, because there's really good information that's going to make so much more sense in this video if you've already watched that.
Yeah.
And so Jim, next up, we're going to be talking about how lamps really affect heat with gel as well. And you've got some really nifty tools here for us to talk about.
Yeah. Two of these tools are lights.
Yeah.
And then the other one happens to be a differential thermometer that we have. And the differential thermometer, the importance of that is that we have two different thermocouples. So a thermocouple is a fancy name for a thermometer. Mm-hmm. So the thermocouple connects to a digital readout. And then the display of that heat is demonstrated here on the readout. One of the thermocouples resides inside the light during the curing process.
Okay.
Because when you turn on the light, you will get some heat being generated by the LEDs.
Mm-hmm.
And as the heat generated from the LEDs is on for a longer period of time, the heat inside the light will increase.
Okay.
So the reason why we use a differential thermometer is because we have one thermocouple that is in the gel and one that is just inside the light. So we're negating the effect of the LED heat on the light.
Right.
So that the differential is more accurate.
Okay, that makes sense.
Yeah, so if we're curing a gel for say a minute, it's possible that the inside of the light temperature could get up by, you know, could increase by 10, 12, 15 degrees.
Yeah.
So we're going to remove that from the exothermic reaction measurement.
Awesome. Yeah, so just taking that general warmth factor into effect. And also, one of the things that we touched on last time, you know, we were talking about how much heat is too much heat, you know, when are we causing tissue damage? And also you were talking about, you know, just the advancements in nail lamps and how all of that technology has changed over the years. And one of the things that I wanted to revisit before we get into the actual measurement of the heat inside of the new LED lamps is talking about how the technology has changed and how that's affected exothermic reactions. So I asked Jim to pull out one of the older style lamps, which uses CFL bulbs. And just to revisit a video that we talked about a couple years ago, we went into very big depth about lamps. So you guys should definitely check that video out, because we do fix some misconceptions about UV versus LED. Both types of lamps emit UV light.
Or near UV light.
But it's the type of bulb that we are using to emit the light we need to cure the gels. So for those of you that have maybe a traditional CFL lamp, compact fluorescent lamp, or maybe you have one of the newer LED models, that also plays a role in how much heat we feel when we cure our gels as well, right?
That means,
okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
So the way that the CFL works is that you actually have a power source, like you plug into your wall.
Mm-hmm.
That power source goes inside the light, and inside the light itself, there's a transformer.
Mm-hmm.
And that transformer generates a lot of heat. And then the bulb generates UV light as well as visible spectrum light. And that light curing the gel creates also heat.
Right.
So the inside temperature of the light increases quite a bit. The hotter the gel, this is something a lot of people don't realize, the hotter the gel is to start out the polymerization reaction, the more heat that's going to be generated.
Wow, okay.
So if you take gel and you put it in the refrigerator or the freezer,
mm-hmm.
cool it down, and then you cure it, its maximum exothermic reaction is going to be far less than it would be if you warmed it up to 120 degrees.
Also, starting point matters.
Starting point does matter, and it controls the speed of the reaction.
Interesting.
In the last video that we made, we talked about molecules in the larger oligomers will delay the entire exothermic reaction over a longer period of time. Same thing happens when you cool down that gel. It delays some of those reaction sites from occurring and causing polymerization. And as a result, less exothermic reaction is generated.
That is super cool.
Yeah.
And so then talking about, you know, how much heat is too much heat and how do we get an idea of that, you were going to demonstrate for us, how do we measure heat in gel and how do we get an idea of how much heat is being produced during the curing process?
Yeah. So we have this thermometer that we brought in from, we have, this is our QC lab thermo, but we go ahead and measure the amount of exothermic reaction that's generated on a dollop of gel that we put onto the form.
Right.
So I use the form, I pull out the little centerpiece.
Mm-hmm.
So that helps control the flow of the gel.
Oh, that's cool.
Yeah.
A little barrier.
It's a little barrier. It's a fence line to keep the sheep in. So,
I like that.
Yeah. So in this case here, it's going to control it. And then we'll go ahead and put this inside the light. We'll put the second thermocouple inside the gel. And then we'll go ahead and start the light.
Awesome.
We're going to do two different experiments.
Okay.
One experiment today is going to be the effect of just a full-blown cure with LED. So the difference in LED versus CFL is that the LED, as soon as the lights come on, you have heat being generated, you have curing occurring immediately. If you have a cold CFL bulb, inside the CFL bulb is mercury. Mercury metal vaporizes with heat. So actually it's mercury vapor that creates the UV light.
Oh, that's really cool. I did not know that.
Stick with me.
I know, right? Learn something new every time.
So the mercury vapor is what creates that UV light. So as the bulb warms up inside the curing light, more UV light is generated.
Right. But it's definitely slower with that warm-up period. It's not an instant on like it is with LEDs.
LEDs, you turn it on, it's going.
Awesome.
You are curing.
Right.
With CFL, the first time you turn it on for the day, it's cold.
Yep.
And as a result, the mercury is cold, it's not vaporized, you aren't regenerating as much UV light.
Yeah. Now, Elegance has a lamp that has a couple really cool features that allows you to also slow down the curing. So you're talking about, we're going to do a test with full-blown light.
Full power.
Full power, straight from the first second. But what's another feature that this LED dot has for nail technicians?
So LED dot also has a hard gel setting for 120 seconds.
Okay.
And it starts out at 25% power. So in the second experiment that we run, we're going to go ahead and keep in mind the peak exothermic reaction of extreme clear gel that's in here right now. We'll do the same test next, and then it'll be with a hard gel setting. And you'll notice that there's significantly less exothermic reaction being generated by the curing gel.
Very cool. All right, so let's do the full-blown,
you ready for this?
Full heat mode and see what we get.
Okay, so thermocouple, stick that into the gel.
Mm-hmm.
And press away. Yep. We're up to 5 degrees, 10, 12. You can see it's really
heating
up in temperature.
Oh, 25. Almost
30.
Almost 30.
35 almost. Yeah, 35. Yeah, we're hitting up to, we're not going to get to 40 degrees, Liz. So the temperature inside this room is about 70. So if the differential temperature between inside the light and the temperature of the gel, if that's 40 degrees or 70 degrees in here, it's going to get to 110.
Yeah. Yeah.
So,
and in our last video, we were talking about kind of, you know, using the analogy of meat, right? If we're talking about tissue damage, you get up beyond 165 degrees. If your gel is doing that, you are going to get some of that soft tissue damage underneath your nail plate or the surrounding skin.
Exactly.
Yeah. Yeah.
And this is one way to mitigate it. So the extreme gel has a lot of oligomer in it.
Mm-hmm.
And because it has a lot of oligomer, it's going to generate less heat per given unit volume. And if we had a lot of monomer in there,
right,
we would be generating a lot more heat.
Yeah, and that's pretty cool to know that even in a 30-second cure with that much gel on the nail at one time, you can get away with curing it all in one fell swoop.
Yeah, that's a pretty healthy slug of gel.
Yeah, that's awesome.
You can use that terminology in a technical reference.
I like that.
Okay, so we're going to go ahead and I'm going to get another sample together.
Okay.
And get that one going.
Awesome.
Okay, so now we have another sample of extreme gel, mm-hmm, about the same volume.
Yeah, it looks about the same.
It's close.
Yep, very close.
And so we're going to go ahead and put that inside the light, but this time are we going to cure it at the full power setting?
No, we're going to do the slow buildup.
We're going to do the 1/22nd setting.
Yep.
And we're going to see what the effect is of 25% exposure or emittance value of the light as it ramps up to 100%.
Yep.
So this light will, it's a great little feature, starts at 25% and ramps its way up to 100% in the first 60 seconds. The second 60 seconds is spent at 100%.
Just make sure you get that full cure.
We'll put it back there about where the same, where the other gel sample was.
Yeah. And you recommend if it needs to be kind of towards the back and the center to get the full exposure of all the LEDs that are in there?
Correct.
Okay.
Okay.
So you hold that and I'll help you out here.
We are set.
Perfect.
So we're starting out
25% power.
Let's see what happens. Not much effect on the heat yet.
Slow ramp up.
Yeah, we're still less than a degree.
Absolutely.
That's a pretty good change.
Yeah, that's a substantial change.
10 degrees.
Yeah.
Yeah, we're at 1 degree.
Talk about slow burn.
That's comfort.
That is major comfort.
Yeah, that's like sitting in first class.
Don't feel anything, just cruising.
6 degrees.
Wow, that's crazy.
Isn't it?
At this point, we're in the 30s, getting close to 40 by this point.
Yeah, because we were at the 30-second setting, and we were starting to come down for almost 40 degrees.
Yep.
And you can see the intensity is really increasing inside the light.
Mm-hmm.
And our temperature has reached 52 degrees.
Oh, wow. Okay.
So, and that could be because it's moving around in there, it's a little closer to the lights.
Yep.
So.
Yeah.
But it started out.
Much slower.
Much slower.
Yeah.
Really low.
And for the client's experience, or even for your own experience doing your own nails, I mean, that makes a huge difference. And especially even if this was a gel that had more of a monomer base to it rather than the oligomer mix that this particular gel has, you can imagine how much of a difference it would make by having that ramp up rather than full intensity straight from the get-go.
Yeah.
Yeah. Makes a big, big difference.
And I bet if we chose the 60-second setting, we could have gotten over that 40-degree mark.
Yes.
That's my hunch.
Yeah, absolutely.
But we're down to 43 degrees at this point.
So you peaked at what, 50-something?
50-ish.
Oh, yeah. 50s. That's good. And then it's important for people to understand, remembering that this is a differential temperature. So it's not necessarily that it's only 50 degrees. It's the difference between the ambient temperature in the lamp and then the temperature of the gel. So we have to put those two together to figure out what the real temperature is.
Exactly.
Yeah. So if our ambient temperature, like you were saying, is what, 70 degrees maybe a little bit warmer, and then we're peaking at 50, we're up into about 120-ish.
But so still far below that critical temperature of 65 degrees.
Absolutely, yeah. Nice hot tub temperature, but no crazy burn.
I'd like to, if your hot tub gets to 120.
I like hot tub temperature.
I'll be in there really short period of time.
Yeah. No, this is awesome. I mean, I think it's really cool for people to be able to see, you know, how the lamp really affects the heat factor with our gels, how we can actually control that through the technology of the lamps that we have available to us and the technology of the gel formulas, like we talked in our last video. And also, to wrap it up, we're going to cover some of the troubleshooting things that you can do physically to also help mitigate some of these issues with heat with our gels as well.
Exactly.
Yeah. So stay tuned for next time. We're going to be talking about what you guys can do to troubleshoot heat, to mitigate heat even further than just lamps and your gel formula.
You have tools you may not even know.
Yeah. Really excited. So we'll see you guys next time.
Thank you.